Country Wife by William Wycherley, with Maggie Smith as Margery Pinchwife, Jonathan Pryce as Horner, John Duttine as Harcourt, John Moffatt as Sparkish, Bernard Hepton as Pinchwife, Harriet Walter as Alethea, Michael Aldridge as Sir Jasper Fidget, Barbara Jefford as Lady Fidget, Anne Beach as Dainty Fidget, Jan Waters as Mrs. Squeamish, and Mary Wimbush as Old Lady Squeamish. London, 1675.
A quack is as fit for a pimp as a midwife for a bawd. They're still but in their way both helpers of nature.
Well, my dear doctor, hast thou done what I desired?
I have undone you forever with the women, Mr. Horner, and reported you throughout the whole town as bad as a eunuch, with as much trouble as if I had made you one in earnest.
But have you told all the midwives you know, the orange wenches at the playhouses, the city husbands, for they'll be the readiest to report it?
I have told all the chambermaids, waiting women, tire women, and old women of my acquaintance, nay, and whispered it as a secret to them, and to the whisperers of Whitehall, so that you need not doubt 'twill spread, and you will be as odious to the handsome young women
as the smallpox. Well,
and to the married women of this end of the town
as their own husbands,
and they will frighten their children with your name, especially the females,
and cry Horn is coming to carry you away. I'm only afraid 'twill not be believed. You told them 'twas by an English-French disaster, and an English-French surgeon who has given me at once not only a cure, but an antidote for the future against that damned malady and that worse distemper, love, and all other women's evils.
Your late journey into France has made it the more credible, and your being here a fortnight before you appeared in public looks as if you apprehended the shame, which I wonder you do not. I have been hired by young Delance to belie him t'otherway, but you're the first who'll be thought a man unfit for women.
Come, come, doctor. The wisest lawyer never discovers the merits of his cause to the trial. The wealthiest man conceals his riches, and the cunning gamester his play. Shy husbands and keepers, like old rooks, are not to be cheated but by a new, unpracticed trick.
There are two ladies and a gentleman coming up.
Oh, pox. Some unbelieving sisters of my former acquaintance, I suppose, who, I'm afraid, expect their sense should be satisfied of the falsity of the report.
Sir Jasper Fidget, Lady Fidget, and Mrs. Dainty Fidget, sir.
Ah! My coach breaking just now before your door, sir, I look upon as an occasional reprimand to me, sir, for not kissing your hand, sir, since your coming out of France, sir. And so my disaster, sir, has been my good fortune, sir. And this is my wife and sister, sir.
What then, sir?
My lady and sister, sir. Wife, this is Master Horner.
Master Horner, husband.
My lady Fidget, sir.
So, sir?
Won't you be acquainted with her, sir? So, the report is true, I find, by his coldness or aversion to the sex, but I'll play the wang with him. Pray salute my wife. My lady, sir.
I'll kiss no man's wife, sir, for him, sir. I have taken my eternal leave, sir, of the sex already, sir.
Ha ha! A pagan yet. Not know my wife, sir?
Oh, I do know your wife, sir. She's a woman, sir. And consequently, a monster, sir. A greater monster than a husband, sir.
A husband? How, sir?
A husband with horns, sir.
Oh!
But I make no more cuckold, sir.
Pray, Sir Jasper, let us be gone from this rude fellow.
Who, by his breeding, would think he'd ever been in France?
Poor Sister Dainty. He's but too much a French fellow. Such as hate women of quality and virtue for their love to their husbands. A woman is hated by him as much for loving her husband as for loving their money. But pray, let's be gone.
Now, you do well, Lady Fidget, for I've nothing that you care for.
What?
Well, I've brought over not so much as a bawdy picture. New postures, nor the second part of the Ecole des Filles.
Oh, for shame, sir. What do you mean? You'll ruin yourself forever with the sex.
He hates women perfectly, I find.
What pity it is he should.
Why, he's a base, rude fellow-fot. But affectation makes not a woman more odious to them than virtue.
Because your virtue is your greatest affectation, madam.
Oh, you saucy fellow. Would you wrong my honour?
If I could.
How do you mean, sir?
No, he can't wrong your ladyship's honour, upon my honour. He, poor man, hark you in your ear, a mere eunuch.
Oh, filthy French such beast. Fool, why do we stay? Let's be gone. I can't endure the sight of it.
Stay but till the chairs come. They'll be here presently.
No, no.
Oh, nor can I stay longer. Tis, let me see, a quarter and a half quarter of the minute past 11. The council will be sat. I must away. Business must be preferred always before love and ceremony with the wise Mr. Horner.
And the impotence, Sir Jasper.
Aye, the impotence, Master Horner.
What? Leave us with a filthy man alone in his lodgings?
He's an innocent man now, you know. Mr. Horner, your servant. I should be glad to see you at my house. Pray come and dine with me, and play at cards with my wife after dinner. You are fit for women at that game yet. It is as much a husband's prudence to provide innocent diversion for a wife as to hinder her unlawful pleasures. And he had better employ her than let her employ herself. Farewell.
Your servant, Sir Jasper.
I will not stay with him.
Nay, madam, I beseech you, stay. If it be but to see I can be as civil to ladies yet as they would desire.
No, for you cannot be civil to ladies.
You were civil as ladies would desire.
No.
Now I think I, or you yourself rather, have done your business with the
world. Madam Ass, Doctor, don't you see already? Upon the report and my carriage, this grave man of business leaves his wife in my lodgings, invites me to his house, and wife, who before would not be acquainted with me out of jealousy.
Nay, by this means you may be the more acquainted with the husband, but the less with the wives.
If I can but abuse the husbands, I'll soon disabuse the wives. Women of quality are so civil, you can hardly distinguish love from good breeding. And a man is often mistaken. But now I can be sure she that shows an aversion to me loves the sport, as those women that are gone, whom I warrant to be right. And the next thing is, your women of honour, as you call them, are only chary of their reputations, not their persons. And 'tis scandal they would avoid, not men. Now may I have, by the reputation of a eunuch, the privileges of one, and be seen in a lady's chamber in a morning as early as her husband. Kiss virgins before their parents or lovers, and maybe, in short, the passepartout of the town. Hmm? Now, Doctor.
Your process is so new that we do not know, but it may succeed.
Not so new, neither. Probatum est, Doctor.
Well, I wish you luck and many patience whilst I go to mine. Ah, Mr. Harker, Mr. Dorrylance, your servant, sir.
Cordial, sir. Come, Horner. Your appearance at the play yesterday has, I hope, hardened you for the future against the women's contempt and the men's raillery. And now you're abroad, as you are wont.
Did I not bear it bravely? What say you, Dorrylance?
With a most theatrical impudence. Nay, more than the orange wenches show there, or a drunken wizard mask, or a great-bellied actress. Nay, or the most impudent of creatures, an ill poet, or, what is yet more impudent, a second-hand critic.
But what say the ladies? Have they no pity, Harcourt?
What ladies? The wizard masks, you know, never pity a man when all's gone, though in their service.
Mr. Sparkish is below, sir.
What? My dear friend... A rogue that is fond of me only, I think, for abusing him.
He can no more think the men laugh at him than that women jilt him. His opinion of himself is so good.
His company is as troublesome to us as a cuckold's when you have a mind to his wife's.
No, the rogue will not let us enjoy one another, but ravishes our conversation, though he signifies no more to it than Sir Martin Marall's gaping and awkward thrumming upon the lute does to his man's voice
in
music.
And to pass for a wit in town, shows himself a fool every night to us that are guilty of the plot.
Such wits as he are so far from contributing to the play that they only serve to spoil the fancy of those that do.
Yet the rogue will hang on.
Yeah, pox on him. And all at force nature, and would be still what she forbids him. Affectation is her greatest monster.
How is Sparks? Oh. How is Sparks? Well, Faith, Harry, I must rally thee a little upon the report in town of thee. Oh, I can't hold it, Faith. Shall I speak?
Yes.
You must know...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.